I work as a futurist. Many of you may wonder what a futurist is, and I'll have a response to that in a second. But in a previous life, I was a musician, composer. I went to Berklee College in Boston for 15 years, and I switched to the internet world in the mid-90s to figure out how to use the internet for music. And it was a very interesting time. And so after a while, you know, I realized that most of my ideas in music business were 5 or 10 years too early, which becomes a problem when you're trying to survive. So I wrote a book in 2003 called The Future of Music that some of you may know. And ever since then, I've been working as a futurist. So basically, my job is this, is to take all these different things that are flying around, which are rather complex, especially in music and in media, and bring them down to a bottom line to help clients reinvent. And I do this for many people around the world, many clients in the music business, in the media business, and many others as well. And just as a disclosure, I do some work for Google and YouTube. Okay, I do not help to advise Google or YouTube on their music policy or any such thing. I think they know what they're going to do there. So it has actually been mentioned several times when I spoke somewhere about the music business that I work for Google. But as a disclosure, I don't work for Google. I sometimes speak for them. So I have no agenda. Exactly the opposite is, in fact, the case. Just recently, I moved all of my email away from Google because of the NSA affair. But different topic. So we live today in a world that has been refined and talked and called many times in a military term, which I don't like using, but it's a good fit, called VUCA: volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. Basically means it's a mess. Okay. So what we're seeing today is a large global change of every single paradigm that we have grown up with in the industrial society. This is not just a music problem. Every content creator, whether you're a writer or a dancer or a producer or a musician or an author, are facing the same problem. Having said that, I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's just an interim area to where we're going to say, well, basically, you know, you can look at it on the left, you can say, oh, God, this is just dystopian mess. You know, we're screwed. Right? I don't think that's true. I think the old system of music, for example, was essentially an aberration. We were extremely lucky when I was a musician to sell CDs because it was possible. But the future holds for us, I think, 5 billion connected people. That's going to be in 3 years, eh? On mobile devices and tablets. Ready to pay because they have virtual money. They pay through the operator. They love music. Our problem is not that people don't want us or are not interested. Our problem is that we haven't quite figured out the model of how to get to their purse yet. Right? And this is really our problem. This is not really a consumer problem. So most of what I want to talk about today is actually not bad. It may sound bad and like a threat, so I want to give you a bit of a warning. Right? It's not dystopian. It just sounds a little bit like it sometimes. First of all, I want to congratulate Sweden. As you know, of course, that's always a good thing to do when you're speaking in a country. Is to congratulate. But anyway, the web index that came out a few days ago praises Sweden on the top number one spot for universal access, relevant content, freedom and openness, and impact and empowerment. And you know what? I think this has a lot to do with women. And we're going to talk about that some more today. The fact that there's so many women involved here. I mean, just look at this audience. I tell you, 95% of my speaking gigs are guys only. So maybe that has something to do there. But also very interesting to see, for example, that the second slot or the third or fourth slot is the UK. Interesting to see that they are only in the fourth slot because they have 100% rating on relevant content about the UK on the internet. Right? Otherwise, they would be all the way down there. And Switzerland is not even on the list where I live. So we'll see what happens there. But the question about music I have, is Sweden and Scandinavia in general showing us the future? I mean, look at this chart. You've seen this before, possibly. A comparison of music revenue change. 37% increase in Sweden. And growth of streaming, 407%. While in the US, the home of pop music, you could say, well, that kind of pop music, minus 5%. So what is so different about Sweden here? Is that a model for the future? And clearly, if we're looking the other way, you know, this is a slide from the New York Times showing that essentially downloading music for money, like one track at a time, has topped out. In other words, if you're hoping to sell downloads one by one, that was a good window for that with iTunes. Right? But you know what? Once you spend $800 on downloading single songs, you eventually stop. It's not like movies where you consume another one, you know, it's not that many. I mean, I stopped at 1,250 euros when my kids used iTunes because they just download and click with my account, right? I'm like, this can't be true. I'm going to end up with 10,000 euros worth of music, right? And you don't actually own it. So no wonder only 2% of the Western population use iTunes to pay for music. That's not a solution, that's a fig leaf. Right? It's a fake promise. I'll talk more about that, why that is, in a second. Really, what's happening now with the internet is that we're facing a radical era of empowerment. And as consumers, we love this. You know, we can rate hotels, we can rate airlines, we can complain about EasyJet on their app, we can do all these things. We can rate doctors, we can rate futurists, we can talk bad about people or good. It's empowerment, right? But in music, the question is, here in Sweden, 70% of revenues are streaming. Is that because the empowerment has happened here? Spotify is bundled with Telia, right, as far as I know. In Denmark, it's TDC and free music in parentheses. Is that the boat that's going to float our money in the future? Providing access. So clearly, however, we're living in a world to where this tidal wave is coming. And I think, again, this is good news, but it's quite overwhelming right now. It's like when you sit on Twitter all day, it's like this huge fire hose of garbage or noise or you know, occasional meaning flooding over you. It's a little bit like this, you know, artists, you know, we're looking at everything becoming digitized and the artists sort of sitting there and saying, oh my God, you know, what am I going to do with this? When I was a musician, I sent CDs out to get gigs, actual CDs, right? I sent out 500 and I was spent all day on the phone calling people for a gig. Now you do that on Facebook. Don't have to call anyone. I mean, that's a big step, right? Digitization. But really, I think what happens here is that the music creator is becoming more powerful because the middlemen are getting crunched. Well, actually, that means that the music creator will be getting more powerful once the crunching is done, I guess you could say. But there's an interesting angle here. What happens in this interim period? And I think we're looking at this global transformation that we're seeing from product, music as a product, which in my view was an aberration because music has never been really a product. Music as a service, and this is growing like crazy and the product is shrinking. Right? We'll be looking at the end of CDs eventually. I mean, in countries like Switzerland, where there's no price sensitivity, people buy whatever. Right? But in Spain or in France or in South America or developing countries on CDs, there's no such thing. I mean, it's a relic. Give your kid a CD for Christmas, they're going to think you have to go to the loony bin. Huh? It's a crazy idea. Huh? So what's going to happen here is that we're moving from product to service to experiences, brands. I mean, why do you like Robin? Why do you like any musician? Not because they just made one CD or one product, because of their brand, of what they stand for, what they say and how they sound. I mean, pretty much like why you like any artist, really. So now I think we're moving in the direction of away from protection. This is a graph depicting what happens in the movie business. And then on the right side is the vast success of Netflix. All media is shifting from protection to engagement. It's as simple as that. If we have engagement, we'll make money. It's literally impossible if you have engagement and attention that you can't turn that into money. The question is how and when, of course. And what are the mechanisms? What are the laws govern this? Currently, most of the laws govern protection. When the protection is meaningless, why would the law covering protection make money? That's like saying, you know, you're going to force something that doesn't exist anymore. There is no protection against people using our stuff. That's what computers do. I mean, so it's an interesting angle to see that we're moving pretty much in this direction across all media. And there's a great quote by Buckminster Fuller. It says, you never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the old model obsolete. And that's what I would like you to do. The old music business is dysfunctional, is egotistical, and is self-obsessed, and is completely not working. I'm not saying all of it, but most of it. And I should know, I mean, it's been 17 years. So this new model is now shaping up. And I think we can see that here in Sweden, very interesting. We'll have a debate about that shortly. So I think it's time to think about this kind of reset. You know, maybe this is a good time for a reset of rights licensing and how that works in Europe. I mean, clearly in Europe, we're going to have one army, one secret service. We're going to have one rights society. That's where we're going. And that could be a company that basically deals with what's called big data, right? Because, you know, rights administration is mostly about data. So maybe STEM and SCAP will end up, you know, running the European society. I don't know. We'll think about that for a second. So, but anyway, what's happening now with technology is that we're living in an exponential world. As Ray Kurzweil, the singularity guru, says, you know, what's happening here is mind-boggling, very hard for us to understand because we are linear. And if we count from 1 to 8, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. When we count exponential, it's 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, and so on. Right? It's exponential. And we're no longer at 2 now, we're at 4, the next point is 8. I mean, the change is a huge exponential wave. So what we need to do here is we need to think about what I call offensive innovation. Not defensive. Not changing a minor thing, you know, so that musicians get their money quicker. Or, you know, whatever, or they, YouTube deals, are those are great, but you know, in the end, what is offensive innovation? That's the question. And it used to be, when Spotify got started on this idea of music like water, it was offensive. Today, it's not. I use Spotify, I'm a very happy user, I love what Daniel is doing. He's a Swedish guy, of course, right? But 7 million users. Have they become part of the problem? Because they're also owned by the labels? Not to say that ownership by the labels is bad, but if there was ever a case for extortion, this would be it, right? You're not going to get to use my music until you give me equity. I'm not sure that's the right approach. Talk more about that in a second, but bottom line is this. We're facing exponential growth of internet users on mobile devices, watching videos and being on the road with their devices. And because of that, all media is becoming disembodied. First it happened with music, MP3s. Right? Now it's movies, Netflix, Hulu, Amazon. Books, the Kindle. Very soon, education, textbooks, banking, money. Money is also a medium, really. So the disembodying of media is inevitable. Yes, it's better for me as a musician to sell a CD. It's better for me. It's better for me as an author to sell a printed book. I can count them. I can keep you from getting one. I can force you to pay. I can do all these things. But it's not going to happen. Right? It's over. Embodiment of media. Some people will still have that and want it. Yes, I love my library. But I'm 53. Do you really think a 20-year-old kid is going to look for your music as an embodied object? Maybe in vinyl, you know, if he's a collector of sorts. Yes, but... So music is about access. You click, it plays. In fact, you could say it's a radioization of the internet. It's free, and you click, and it plays. So what do we do about this? I think really what's happening is here that this disembodiment is forcing us to create a collective EU-wide approach of how we solve this problem. Structural problem. This is not a technical problem. It's a structural problem. Because this is the reality that we have to face, and I think this is a good thing. Copying is the same as listening. There's no difference. Now, if you're a lawyer, I'm sure there's some lawyers here, God forbid, in the audience, it's the same thing, right? Guess what? A mechanical right is the same in a public performance, right? It's the same, there's no difference. When you stream something online, it makes a copy. Every person in this room knows how to get an MP3 from YouTube. It's called Download Helper, right? If you ever heard about it. I mean, YouTube has 1.2 billion users, and they're getting music for free. That's it. When you go to a party, that's how they play the music. There's no hard drive, there's no BitTorrent. I mean, BitTorrent is for old guys. It streams. And why would I use Spotify for 10 euros if it's free on YouTube? And can I also tell YouTube not to do this? I can, because it's promotion. I need YouTube as an artist. So copying is the same as listening. Why do we make a legal difference? Why do we still act like the copying is expensive? The listening is free. Makes no sense. The incarnation of this trend is the mobile device. 80% of the entire world's internet traffic in 3 years will be on mobile devices. So if you think that you have a solution for people downloading one track at a time and paying you 2 euros, well, look somewhere else. What they're doing here is they have a mobile device, they click into place, that's it. And it may save it for later or not, but this is what people are doing. The Brazilians, the Russians, the Indians, and the Indonesians will not be using iTunes and paying by the unit. Maybe four of them will do that. So here's the reality, and I face this reality very much myself as an author now. I wrote 5 books, my books are on the Kindle, same thing. Bottom line is this, the revenue per unit, the green bar, is rapidly declining. We're looking at a value reduction of 90%, basically, or more, sometimes less. But the audience is exploding. So here's an example, right? CD and vinyl, say 2 euros or 20 euros, right? 20 euros. iTunes gives me 2 euros for a download, where I have to pay 2 euros. Right? Spotify, very little. Pandora, even less. And YouTube, nothing, really. Whose fault is this? Well, should we look whose fault it is? This is what happens in digital systems. It's efficient. Distribution is not a cost any longer. So we have this value decline per unit, but the audience is going up from my 100 people that I have here to a potential of 5 billion or whatever fraction of that I can get. So do the math. What's better for us? I mean, first of all, of course, it's inevitable. There's nothing we can do about this. I mean, this is digital efficiency. It's exactly the same thing in an airline saying people can compare prices of flights and therefore have to be cheaper and more transparent and better, right? That's what we ask them to do. Same thing. So what's happening here is that the inevitable result of all of this is lower per unit cost for the consumer and income for us, but a much higher audience. I'll go through some math in a second to explain how this could work. But there's nothing we can do about this. I mean, if you're watching a movie on Netflix, you have Netflix here in this country, I think, right? We don't have it in Switzerland. We're not worthy. But here, if you watch on Netflix, do you know how much money the studio is getting from you for this? Like 16 cents? You know how much money they're making when you buy a DVD? 24 euros? You think they're happy with this? But Netflix has 43 million subscribers. 43 million. And NBC Universal is getting some $350 million a year from what we do here with their stuff, with their TV shows. Well, what's better for them? Is it to say, no, we don't do this, we don't collect this money, and to sue people for piracy? They license Netflix. Not everywhere, but... And music is not unique. This is a graph showing what's happening in telecom. I mean, all of you guys know, of course, WhatsApp and Viber and iMessage. That's how you bypass the operator, right? No more SMS. You have your buddy in Tanzania, you use WhatsApp. Right? That's what happens in the red line. Over-the-top messaging is beating SMS. And SMS is a $320 million revenue stream per day. Don't you wish you were in that business, right? $320 million per day. It's gonna go away. It's dying. Because now users have the internet, they can do whatever they want for messaging. Anything, really. What are they going to do about this? Same problem. So when distribution becomes abundant, which means everywhere, anytime, at lower cost, then new things become scarce. Distribution is no longer the problem. On the flip side, distribution is no longer the money maker. Flip side of that is, there's new scarcity. What brand... What relevance, what context, what timeliness? You know, I subscribe to only 3 things, or 4 things online, actually. Spotify. And then in terms of magazines, I subscribe to The Economist, and to Wired, and The Guardian. And The Economist, you know, you may know The Economist. I never actually read The Economist. I throw away the printed copy as soon as it arrives. I listen to The Economist on my app. It's an audio track when I drive. Right? It reads the magazine to me. That's why I pay $150 a year to The Economist, only because the writing is good and it reads to me. Yeah? That's the new scarcity, my eyes, my time. So clearly, no wonder, looking at this chart from Henry Blodgett from last week, that new media companies on the left are valued more than twice as important on the stock market than the old media companies. That's what they do. They add value, or they try. You can argue, of course, they're exploiting. Of course, you can argue that. But where are things going? I mean, all of these guys want to be these guys. It's a trend that we're seeing everywhere. So because I've been in the music business, you know, on and off as a satellite, I could say, for a long time, this is our main problem, right? We're living in ego land. It's like it's all about us. It's about my revenue stream, my turf, my authority, the way I do things. I mean, I've never seen such a dysfunctional system in my life anywhere else, and I meet a lot of people, right? I mean, even the banking business beats the music business, and that's saying a lot, right? We have to fix this, right? This whole idea of saying, you know, this is what I do, and this is what you do, and stay out of my turf, and we can't compete, and I mean, where is this going to go? This is a typical scenario of a zero-sum mindset. The pie is limited, I get it, you don't get it. That's not the future. This pie is growing. It's not a zero-sum game with 5 billion consumers. We're not competing on that level. We're competing with other media. So this is what I call the egonomy. This is not a music economy. It's a music egonomy. I mean, there's four companies who are running recorded music. And then there's an independent one that it's acting like a major company. Merlin. But so we have an egonomy, right? And really what we need an ecosystem, a functioning ecosystem to make this work. That's what Europe is all about. I mean, you want to go back to America, you're back at the egonomy, right? This is why it's not working over there. We need to think of an ecosystem. Peter Drucker, a great management guru, said, the greatest thing in times of danger is not the change or turbulence itself, but is to act with yesterday's logic. And God knows this has happened in the music business until like yesterday, okay? Well, it's good to see that it's actually not happening here, right? Considering that we have this event here and actually speak openly about these issues. Right? Yesterday's logic, protection. If I don't protect my music, nobody will pay. And what kind of logic is that? It's like forcing to love, same thing. Right? It's an oxymoron. Content is king? Why do we even ask that question? Of course, content is important, but there's so many more things that are triggers for purchase. That's what it's all about. Why would you buy something? Context, relevance, timeliness, brand, packaging. And it's not just one thing. Right? And of course, the ultimate one is this one. Customer control. That's iTunes. I love Steve Jobs, rest in peace. I am an Apple guy, but that's going to work in the future? Not in your wildest dreams, it wouldn't. This is what's going to work in the future. This is a slide from my friend Ross Dawson, also a futurist, talking about the newspaper business. And we call this the reason to buy. Guess what? There's 150 reasons to buy, depending on who you are. Maybe you're into interfaces, maybe you're into relevance, maybe you're into Flipboard and you'll pay a premium to see it better, maybe you're into novelty, reputation, whatever the reason is. It's a combination of things, of added values. That's what Spotify does well. I don't buy Spotify because I listen to music. In fact, I don't use it much for that. I look at the playlist of my friends. I share stuff on Facebook. I find new artists. It's all those things. That's why I pay. So the new generatives, they make the royal family, right? So don't ask content is king. Content is a royal family. It's more than one thing. So, what we need to do is to go away from the industrial mindset of the music business, which is truly industrial. Industrial in that very sense of this picture, to this mindset. This is the Osani tribe in Africa. They create a game that only works if everybody is connected, right? Everybody is working out. So basically we have to go to the digital exponential mindset. We have to not control distribution, but monetize attention. I'll talk in a second what that means. We have to go from monopolistic ecosystems to an ecosystem. And this is incidentally what Europe is facing right now. Either we create this ecosystem of working together or we're finished. Because there's no alternative. We can't keep on pursuing an ecosystem. Take television. What's happening in television is that people who have cable TV are not going to cut it tomorrow because they're used to it. You know, my wife is not going to cancel our cable subscription. It costs 100 euros or so because she likes to surf around there. Right? She's used to that. But when you're 20, you'll never sign up for cable because you have this, right? You have over-the-top apps. Do you need to sign up for cable or satellite? Well, you just use, you know, Apple TV, Roku, whatever. It's all there. So you're getting the same thing for a fraction of the value. It's no longer about distribution, but about attention. And we have to embrace that. It's a bitter pill when you have been in the distribution business. Okay, so, you know, the people who made the horseshoes for the horses were not happy about the train arriving. But you can't outload the train because you're a horseshoe owner, you know. So interesting to see that the streaming market took off in countries like Mark Mulligan, a music expert, says, where the download market didn't start. Already, like, you know, you see here Sweden, Norway, Netherlands, France, Deezer, and so on, right? I mean, clearly, in the markets where hardware dominates, America, England, Germany, then it's all about single downloads. It's kind of interesting to see that Apple owns 83% of the download market worldwide, but they make almost no money with music. They make money selling boxes. I mean, they could drop out, they could give all the music for free. It wouldn't make a difference to them. They sell more stuff with apps. They make more money with apps than with music. And we're looking to them to help us? God forbid. I mean, look at this, what's happening here. It's totally obvious. You know, this one line being a subscription service and the other one is paid to download. UK, USA, Germany, Japan, it's working there because these are hardware-dominated places. People buy hardware and they're large. Looking at this, it's totally clear where we're going with this. I mean, the green line is a decline in physical purchases, you know, CDs. The blue one is online and the red line is mobile. We're going all the way to mobile. And when you're on mobile, you can see here, U.S. mobile music revenue, guess what it is? 86% advertising supported. This is U.S., right? We'll never be that high here. But do you know how much money people are spending on advertising, brands? I mean, in music business, you can't even find it under the rug if you compare the proportion. It's $680 billion a year is spent in advertising. The average value of an internet user is $49 per year. You don't think there's enough money to pay for music when the scale is there? It's clear, the numbers are totally obvious. There is no long-term mass market for selling downloads. This is something that happens on the side, or could be a premium, for example, in high definition. Yes, but it's about access, selling access. So you may have heard about the plans of the Maldives to rebuild themselves as this. As a fake resort, about the Venetian Hotel, where 68% of Americans that go to the Venetian Hotel in Las Vegas say they will not go to Venice, Italy, because it's the same thing. Right? Well, nothing against Americans, of course, but what the point I'm trying to make here is this, right? It's fake. Right? It's not real. Fake scarcity is misleading both the artist and the consumer. Fake scarcity means people will pay for one song whatever we ask for them to pay because we make it scarce. And iTunes is saying that if you are downloading another song, you have to pay again. That's fake scarcity. It's not real. This is only for people who have unlimited budget, like us, basically. But not for our fans. I mean, again, I love Apple and iTunes. It was great what they did, but we have to move further than this. Right? Fake scarcity is not going to work. It's not going to help us. The CEO of Netflix, Reed Hastings, he calls this problem with distribution managed dissatisfaction, meaning that we were always really pissed off about how it was working, but there was nothing else to do. So if you want to watch a movie, you have to have HBO in America. Or you want to watch a sports game, you have to have a sports channel. Right? You have to have satellite. If you want to buy music, you had to buy a CD, and so on and so on. And iTunes was the epitome of managed dissatisfaction. I mean, think about that for a second. When you die, God forbid, your entire music library is gone. Nobody has the right to get your ID and your music. You don't actually own it. And when you watch a movie on iTunes, you fall asleep. Guess what happens the next day? Can't watch it. It's only 24 hours. Great. Right? I mean, I do this. I mean, it's amazing that I actually do this. But anyway, so it's not a sustainable business. It's a Godzilla, basically. I mean, if you look at what's happening here, paid downloads in the US, percentage gain and loss, dead. Don't stake your life on paid downloads. I know it sounds good from the outside, right? Because it's, you know, it's unit sales, we can count them. But it won't work. 43 million subscribers Netflix has. $10 a month, unlimited viewing. What's the damage if we do this? And $10 for movies translates into, guess what? $1 for music in the equivalent, right? In the logical equivalent, because, you know, it takes 2 hours to watch a movie. And how many are you going to watch? 40 a month? I mean, not if you're not unemployed. Right. So, I mean, look at the growth here that we're seeing. I'll give you a short comment from Kevin Spacey, who you may know is a star of Netflix series called House of Cards, which I very much recommend. I think it's actually on Netflix. Not that I can watch it on Netflix, but he has a very interesting comment about music.
Clearly, the success of the Netflix model, releasing the entire season of House of Cards at once, proved one thing. The audience wants the control. They want the freedom. If they want to binge, as they've been doing on House of Cards and lots of other shows, then we should let them binge. I mean, I can't tell you how many people have stopped me on the street and said, thanks, you sucked 3 days out of my life. And through this new form of distribution, we have demonstrated that we have learned the lesson that the music industry didn't learn. Give people what they want, when they want it, in the form they want it in, at a reasonable price, and they'll more likely pay for it rather than steal it. Well, some will still steal it, but...
You get his message, right? I mean, that's the message. So what are we doing wrong here? Whose problem is this? Why are we whining about how little Spotify pays us? I mean, they have 7 million subscribers. Right? I mean, that's like less people than go buy groceries today at the grocery store, on average. We need 700 million subscribers. How do we get there? Distribution as a key revenue driver is a burning platform, just like the BP platform. It's dying. That's the future. Brand and attention. If people like you, they click on your stuff many, many, many times, and you accumulate money through this. Well, I'll show you on the business model side how that works. But that is our future. It's all about this. I mean, the reason I'm here is because I'm somewhat a brand. Right? I mean, you can watch my YouTube videos. There's 150 of them on my channel. And just watch that and never come to see me. It's about brand and audience. I mean, it's not new. So the consumer is standing there and saying, giving us a very simple message that we have to look at. He's saying, is happy to pay cash or pay with attention, which is usually data in the sense of Google or YouTube, right? Highly personalized, timely, social, meaningful, relevant, but it must be on the 100% irresistible terms. If you're not okay with that, leave the music business. You can't argue with the 5 billion people. And lots of people have done this right. I mean, Jeff Bezos, the guy who owns Amazon, he just bought the Washington Post, the most politically widespread newspaper in the world. It's going to stop printing. That's what I think, right? Because he wants to change the model. This is really offensive innovation. So it must be 100% irresistible. And ask yourself a question. Is Spotify, as much as I like it, 100% irresistible? The answer is, it's for me because I don't give a shit about 10 euros. Right? But it's not in general. The hurdle is too high. How do we get 700 million people on Spotify? We reduce the hurdle. Oh, of course, we can't do that because the labels own them, right? So, sorry, we can't solve that problem right away. But the message is really clear. I mean, if you're looking at this chart, right, consumers want cheap, bundled, or feels like free, and then they're going to take the next step. They want to be convinced first. So on the left, you see all the stuff that people do. Watch music videos, download a song on the internet, stream music, watch music. And the last point, the little box is, paid to download an album. I mean, it's obvious what consumer wants. We have to do something to make this work. So now we're on this path, and it's very interesting to see that how the change is happening in the last 2 years, which gives me hope about the dysfunctional family of the music business. But it used to be that free beats everything. Now that we know that everybody's listening to everything that we do, and we become naked, and the NSA is looking at our very, you know, at a secrets that we have, and Google knows more about you than your wife. So their control and distribution was essential. That's the logic, clearly. Because if you don't, then it's free. But the future is the reverse. All of a sudden, we're looking at this saying, it's about value, trust, relevance, and it's about earning and keeping attention. Right? This is a huge shift that's happening in this path, because people are on mobile devices, right? So we're going to see this kind of shift towards services like this. And this is really great news for us. People are willing to pay. That's why they pay for Netflix, for Flickr, for Farmville, where they used to pay for Farmville, or for LinkedIn. Right? People pay. This is a game changer. So I call this a forced evolution of music. And we're here now at this point to where we happily sold copies. And that was a huge bubble that we loved because we can count them. I mean, it's a human, you know, touch it and count it, it's real, right? Now we have to license access. That's what it's all about. License access. And then, on top of that, we generate new premiums. High definition, concert recording, remixes, different language versions, synchronization, blah, you name it, right? There's hundreds. If we skip this part and say we don't like to license access because it's a dangerous model, because people may stop buying copies, they will stop buying copies. I mean, if you haven't understood that yet, you've got a problem. You really think in 10 years, kids will learn from printed books? And they'll be digital textbooks. I mean, they'll be in the cloud. It's completely obvious. So what we see here, we have a model for that. It's called radio. Radio makes legal what used to be illegal by providing a license. We have to do the same thing. I've talked about this for a long time. So clearly, one of the bottom lines here is that access-based revenues are doing great. Publishing, synchronization, public performance. I mean, look at the chart of the publishers. They haven't suffered much from the internet. Right? And over here, I mean, record income from the performing rights organizations, like in Sweden. That clearly shows us it's about licensing access, not copies. Copies are the same. I know it's painful if your lawyer will give you nightmares. Yeah? How are you going to make money, you know, suing people in the future? So the legal structure of the music business needs to be rethought and transformed, like this car becomes a robot. Right? And the worst part, you know, because I live in Switzerland, I can tell you this is the worst part. This cartoon says, we've considered every potential risk except the risk of avoiding all risks. And this is where we're at. It's like, what risk? I mean, what are you talking about here? The risk is to die or to try to live. That's the risk you're facing. Now, pick one. Pick one. That's our risk. There's nothing else here. There's only those two options. So how would we get to a $10 billion recorded music, not publishing, music market in Europe? Here's an example. Okay. $1 per internet user in Europe per month. For music. €1, sorry. Right. So currently that means 600 million internet users. 600 million a month. Okay. Euros. 7.2 billion a year. That's 40% of the current global music market. €1 a month. Okay. Now, that euro doesn't even have to be paid by them. Because guess what? A euro a month, I can easily find a way to bundle that. Advertising, streaming, marketing, sponsorship, it's a euro, you know. I'll show you some facts about this. Would anybody not have Spotify or Deezer or Simfy if it was a euro? And if they didn't have to pay but just pick the right provider, like TDC or Telia, be no-brainer, problem solved. Upselling from the 1 euro to dozens of premiums. For example, you could say, well, for the euro, you can only keep, you know, for what you do here, you can only keep 50 or 100 songs on your mobile, not 2,000. Or you don't get HD, or you don't get the concerts, or whatever. You know, you can do some reasonable bundling. And then you can say, well, you know, for 5 euros extra that you pay directly, you can unlock this, like the pro badge on Flickr, you know. Add another 400 million mobile phone users. Clearly the stats are there. That's the average revenue. That the Europe has the highest internet penetration in the world. I mean, our countries are perfect for this. I mean, we're seeing how ad spending is increasing on the internet. It's a no-brainer. This is the same logic. Why is this not happening? Well, of course, you know, because those that own distribution don't like this idea. Artists would love this. I mean, wouldn't you love 7.2 billion a year as money, as guaranteed money, minimum money? So looking at the giants, what they've done on the internet, you know, Apple, Google, Amazon, they've gone from the core business into new areas. And what they've done is they are already looking at this and saying, music is indispensable for us, but guess what? They already see music as disembodied and mobile and social and cloud-based added value. They're already doing this. And no matter what work I do for them, I have to tell you, these people are going to go ahead with this idea. Yeah. So what's our response to this? Why don't we go to YouTube and say, you know what? 1 euro a month that you can easily make with advertising, you put the download button next to the video. And that could be provided by Spotify or wherever I care, right? Easy, be no-brainer. Because people already are doing this on YouTube, right? They're already downloading the MP4 and the MP3 without paying. It's ridiculous that we haven't done this. I mean, I can't figure out why we haven't come to a solution yet. The money is there. You don't think the money is there? Online advertising will take 50% of the entire global advertising budget in the next 3 years. We're talking about $300 billion. You don't think they'll get a measly $10 billion for music out of this? You know, it's clearly, it's hard to see the stats there. But so the question I have for Europe and for the Swedish leaders to lead Europe, that's my only hope. The Swiss people won't do it, they're not even Europe. But can Europe create a new digital music ecosystem? This is our future. That we have to create this. And it's really about the shift that I call from ego to eco. You know, this is an interesting illustration I found on Tumblr, so I'm using it. I don't know who did it, but it fits me. The thing is, we need this, right? That's leadership. We need people who are going to put their brain on a rocket. And they're hard on a rocket to actually go out and suggest this and not come up with minor fixes. We need a reset that goes away from this idea of saying we're going to control everything to a biosphere. I mean, this is where we're going with all business, really, not just with music. Netflix is a biosphere. Netflix is now a producer of videos. They've gone from a distributor to a publisher and a producer. This is happening to everyone there. It's about the transformation. So I'll wrap up, and then we'll have our discussion with Paul. So bottom line is, we have to collaborate now, or we get squashed. That's our choice. Let me ask you this question. Why do you think Netflix exists, and people are paying this much money for movies, while we haven't gotten anyone to go beyond 10 million subscriptions in music? It's not that people don't like music. Because we've tried to eat the pie and have it. Right, to not endanger what was before. And this, of course, is by and large not the issue with artists, right? But artists have supported this among their organizations, and we should discuss later. So we are now at a pivotal point. Either we can keep running around in circles while everybody is trying to innovate the business and will eventually squash everyone else, right? Or we can take a detour, and we can actually break this cycle. So a brief summary, Okay, point one. The CD, physical media, is quickly disappearing in the rear of a mirror. And that's going to happen. And downloading singles, same thing. It's disappearing. It's still here. It's still growing. I'm sure you're happy about iTunes revenues, if you get any. Great, but that's temporary. Manage dissatisfaction won't make the pie bigger. We're not going to get more money from the consumers by telling them what to do or how to, you know, be dissatisfied but somewhat stay around. Streaming and access is the new ownership. We need new laws for this. If streaming is the same as owning, then we have to change the law. We have to make it legal to stream and to own at the same time, which currently really it isn't. I mean, it's perverse to see that most people use YouTube as a digital jukebox, and it's very easily possible to convert the song any which way you like. At the same time, of course, the argument made is only streaming. I mean, everybody knows it's a fig leaf, so we may as well look at this. So access may result in a 90% reduced unit price, but it has 1,000 times the audience. Yes, it will take some time to build this. No, we won't get there if we charge 10 euros outright. We can charge 10 euros later, right, as an upsell. We need digital music licenses that enable billions of users to generate money. If we're going to generate money from 2% of the population like we're doing now with iTunes and Spotify and others, yes, it's not going to be good. We need everyone to be able to contribute. Many new premiums can be offered on top of this, and we'll discuss in the conversation. The really sort of new or even old, you could say, embodiment of music is the artist himself, herself. It's the band. The embodiment is the artist. That's what it should be, and that's what it always has been. And we're going back to this in the digital environment because in the end, you cannot copy a person. You can copy a file. This is the value of the artist. I mean, the artist is going to get more stronger in this relationship, and that is exactly what the problem is in the eyes of the industry. Right? It's like the user and the artist getting stronger is not going to be a good position for me to get 90% of the money in the middle. Right? So, social media clearly are big opportunities. We'll talk about that. In the EU, I think we need offensive innovation, real leadership, hyper-collaboration. I mean, 3 years ago, the US Post Office, one of the largest organizations in the world headed for bankruptcy, like Kodak, right, made a deal with UPS to stay alive. UPS was the arch enemy, the worst entity in the world to compete with the US Post Office. They got together and made a deal to survive. It's going to be the same thing for us. We need to hyper-collaborate with all possible entities to get to a solution quickly. So thanks for your time. You can download this presentation on my website sometime this afternoon when I get online at futuristgerd.com. Thanks very much for listening, and now I look forward to a nice conversation. Thanks very much.
So, good morning. My name is Paul Brindley. I'm from Music Ally in London. And first of all, can I just say thanks very much to Martin and Alphonse and everyone here for inviting me to this great event in such a lovely surroundings too. I'm really delighted to be here. I'm particularly pleased to be able to have a chance to respond to Gerd and give him a bit of a grilling, and then we're going to have more of a discussion with some great panelists that are going to join us in a moment. But let's just kick off. I agree with you, most of what you say, I think. You know, I mean, I don't think many people would dispute the fact that we're moving from a world of ownership towards a world based upon access, that eventually the CD probably will disappear. In some markets, it's going to linger longer. Obviously, it's not uniform everywhere. But, you know, when you talk about sort of control going away and the control over distribution going away, you look at Spotify, you look at YouTube, what are they if they're not distribution channels?
They're platforms. I mean, YouTube is our platform. I mean,
well, hang on. It's distributing music to the consumer, isn't it? It's a platform that distributes music.
Yeah, but the distribution part of YouTube... and Twitter and other social media platforms is not the main part, right? The main part of that is the connectivity of people and what they decide to use, right? And this is why they're a little bit like radio. It's very social, it's collective, there's no central programming, right? So distribution, yes, that's one of their components, but you know, distribution from their point of view is free. And this is, of course, how they make their living, being, you know, what Jaron Lanier calls siren servers. You know, they have their own reasons for doing that.
I guess my point is, and you know, you didn't actually talk so much today. You have talked in the past a little bit more about kind of disintermediation, the idea that perhaps labels become a little bit more relevant. I tend to think, actually, it's almost the opposite that's really happening, that what we've now got, yes, we've got a new opportunity to go direct to the consumer, on the net, but you know, it's actually a much more complicated world in which we live, and to manage all these channels, the new channels as well as the old channels in the current state that we're in, is it just not actually even more complicated? And therefore, you know, you do need these kind of intermediaries. You need to know a lot about how to reach the consumer, and that's you know, that's distribution.
Well, you always need intermediaries if you're an artist, right? Because you don't want to deal with the marketing and stuff yourself. So there is a role for labels, there is a role for publishers. Of course, there's a role for societies, copyright societies and performing rights organizations, yes. But that role is strictly between satisfying the artist and the consumer. There's no other place for that. There's not a self-satisfying role that we had until now. That's basically, if it fits us, then we'll help the artist or we'll help the consumer. You know, there's a deadly attitude. So distribution as such is in the cloud. Right? It's just there. So we can decide to say that we don't like it to be there and we don't want to get paid, or we can legalize it and collect in a way that we will get paid. Right? I mean,
But that's exactly what Spotify is.
Yeah, it sure is. But of course, from this, I mean, as I said earlier, from my point of view, I quite like how they're doing this, and I don't care about the 10 euros. I'm just saying it's not going to be a solution for 700 million or a billion people because of the proposal. If we are successful...
But is that just because it's too expensive?
I'm not saying it's too expensive. I'm fine with that, right? I'm just saying we don't get mass penetration with that kind of model, right? And we need mass penetration, like radio.
But why should every consumer... I don't think every consumer... I think there's a bit of an arrogance going on in this argument, to be honest, to expect everyone, every internet user, to want to pay 1 euro a month.
That's not what I'm saying. It's like they won't actually pay in the end. They pay with their attention, like they do now. I mean, this is the most common variant of what we're seeing on the web, is that when I go somewhere like Google, YouTube, Twitter, I pay with my presence. You know, I create momentum. Right? I pay with my data. In many cases, I pay with my privacy, you could argue, right? So they make money because I'm there. And because I'm there, they add the music, I'm going to be there even more. It generates value to a certain point.
Why should the intermediaries, the ISPs, the people that are providing the pipes that get to the access and distribution, call it what you will, why should they be paying the music industry all this money?
Well,
they're going to pay if something adds value to their users. But I think, you know, what we've found, unfortunately, over the past decade or so, is that perhaps, you know, what we thought in terms of how much value music services could add to telcos and ISPs, it just hasn't really proven to be the case. Now, that's largely because it's been priced too highly, but, you know, do you really think, I mean, of course it's a lovely simplistic solution to say, if everybody in the whole world paid, you know, a dollar, a euro a month, it's called
radio, Paul. I mean, radio had exactly the same problem. And how much money did radio make for a long time for all of us? It made a boatload of money if you were popular, right? If you're not, then you didn't get any money. But it was basically deemed legal after the fact that everybody used it. And YouTube is the same thing. I mean, YouTube went and did this without asking anyone, and now they are de facto way of life. Right? And so what are we going to do about these guys? We're going to say, you know, you have to go back and not do this? I mean, we have to actually legalize them and collect. That's exactly the same problem. So, I think it's completely obvious here that you know, for an ISP or a mobile operator, a euro a month based on advertising that they could actually get probably more than the euro back, right? This would be absolutely...
What if they don't want to offer that music?
Well, I can tell you, I've been involved with about 30 of them. And, you know, when I talk to telcos, especially around the world, the number one thing is that they're saying, we're not doing music because these people are ridiculous.
Because it's too expensive, yes, to get the licenses.
Yeah. Not only that, but...
If every telco and ISP had the same kind of basic deal, what's the point?
Well, the
point not
would
be
that,
differentiated, is it?
The point would be that you do something else on top of the deal. I mean, I don't listen to radio stations because they have a license to play music. You know? I listen to radio stations because of what they play and how they play and who the personalities are. It's exactly the same thing here. I would use Deezer or Spotify if they had a public license like that because they look different, they do different things, they have different plugins, they have different whatever, right? Different feel to it, not because they're legal. Nobody uses Spotify because they're legal. Right?
No,
because they have benefit.
It's
right?
convenient. It's a much better way of, just like Netflix. You know, right. I mean, I could go and download Breaking Bad from the internet, but instead, I much prefer watching it on a very convenient
right.
service.
I think the bottom line is that
I don't live in Switzerland.
Let me bring it to the bottom line. Okay, the problem with the streaming services is that we come from our value perception, which comes from the CD. So we're trying to get the maximum we can out of those poor suckers that are still paying. Okay. And this is fundamentally wrong because what it does, it takes the same model and extrapolates it forward and says, we're getting XYZ for the CD, XYZ from AirPlay, XYZ from these guys, and so therefore this is the Spotify price, and now, you know, incidentally, we also own Spotify, right? So now we can extend the same thinking, which gets us into exactly the same trap, right? Which means everybody else is doing this for free while we're asking for 10 euros. If we were able to say that we get absolutely everyone connected to a service like this and then upsell to other platforms, we'd make a boatload of
okay,
money.
Okay, so, well, let's get down to a bit more reality then as to how we get there. How do you get that kind of license? What is it? Is it a compulsory license? Is it a statutory license? How do we get to the point where ISPs can get this license to offer all music for a euro a month charged to the consumers?
Well, I think what's happening is quite obvious is that the refusal to deal with the reality of what is actually happening results in a disconnect to where this is happening in parallel to us saying that it shouldn't be happening. Right? And as you can see now in the last few months, every artist is complaining about how little Spotify pays them. At the same time, Spotify is going to go bankrupt if they keep paying the same thing with 7 million users or 10 or whatever they have, right? So there's a fundamental disconnect there, right? To get that license means a legal framework that says this is how we're going to go about it in general, right? If that can be achieved, maybe it has to be done on a national level, right?
So it's a compulsory license.
It's a collective voluntary license is what I would prefer, but, you know, yes.
Well, yeah, but if the rights owners don't agree, how are you going to get to the point? You're going to force, right? I mean, let alone the situation where, I mean, look, you know, I was in a band. My old band have been dormant for a number of years, but they're actually thinking of doing stuff now. And, you know, they like to think that they could sort of manage the way that they come back and make a reappearance, and that might be doing an exclusive deal here or an exclusive deal over there. There's a lot of artists, as we know, who are, you know, already not happy with having their music on Spotify. Now, as a consumer, that's really annoying that there are gaps in the catalogue. But what are you saying? Are you saying, like, well, too bad, we're just going to force, you know, you have no right at all any longer to control.
You can have your right and not get paid. What do you prefer? I mean, this is what it comes down to. That's a great idea, that I have the right to refuse. You know, I'm not talking about a motion picture with my music or so, which is different. I'm talking about people listening, downloading my music.
And where does that stop? Why just music? Why not films, books? It's all digital content. So why not have a compulsory license? Why is music so special that it should be treated as an isolated case? That the state, that governments should intervene to force you as a musician, as a composer, as a recording artist, as a rights owner, a label, a publisher, to have no rights over how you choose
to distribute
your content?
I'm not saying that the state should intervene. I'm saying that we as creators and as people who live in this society, as users also, right, we have to create a solution that is a fit for 98% or 100% of the population. Okay, and how we get there, you know, there's only two choices. As I said before, you know, either the system collapses, which is imminent, basically none of us
well,
getting
it's not
any
imminent, is it? Because it's actually revenues are beginning to grow.
Yeah, but
it's turning. It's not. You know, we're not back to the heady days of a decade ago, right? but
well, if you
it's
call
not
it
collapsing.
If you call the solution a 90% reduction, then I call that a collapse. You know, this is what we're looking at.
It's shrunk and revenues have gone elsewhere. The live music market has expanded enormously.
Yeah.
Publishers have not been hit quite so hard as labels. It's not a 90% reduction overall.
Well, but no, yeah.
In the music industry,
there's new revenue streams with synchronization and other things like that. Yes, true. But at the same time, selling music, right? I mean, the fact that I want to sell music de facto doesn't really exist anymore. I mean, if you're lucky, it does, right? Because you're a certain segment that can still sell physical music or downloads or so. But the rest is about access, right? So if there's no provision to license my access, then I'll never make any money from it. So if I'm unlucky in 5 years, there's no more CDs, I'm part of all the streaming services, right? But they're only licensed to the illustrious
2%. But you still haven't answered my question. Why is music? Why should music be a special case? Why do we stop at music? Or do we have compulsory licensing for all digital content? Where do we stop?
Well, music is special, of course, in any case, because the way that you use music is not at all the same than reading a book or watching a movie, right?
So I agree with that. I was going to come to that.
So the value equation, you know, if I buy a book on the Kindle, I can get any book I want. Just go to bookmates.ru if you speak Russian, okay? Get any book you want. But it's an ugly PDF. Mm. Right? Or you can download a .mobi file and send it to your Kindle. Right? Most people don't know how to do this. Right? So, okay, so I spend $5 on this book on the Kindle. I don't read 100 books a year. I mean, I do, but most people don't. Right? So therefore, $5 is okay for a Kindle book. Right? And I read it for 10 hours. So it's well-spent money. A movie I watch for 2 hours, I want to watch a nice quality HD stream. I don't want it to flicker and stuff. Right? So therefore, you know, I'm willing to spend because it's an experience on a big screen. Right? Music is ephemeral. You know, it's in the ether. Right? It's in my car. It's in my mobile, and it goes by in 3 minutes. Right? So therefore, the way that I look at the time spent versus money spent is less, at least initially. So when I'm a music fan, like on Spotify, I find artists there, and I pay for that on Spotify. But if I really like their stuff, maybe I will download and pay for the app, for example.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to bring on Daniel and Lena in a second, but one last question, just to sort of follow on, because you know, you do often refer to Netflix and, you know, the Kevin Spacey point, which I think you could say, okay, look, the music industry was very slow to get to where we've got to today, and the movie industry obviously is getting there a little bit more quickly, though it was equally as defensive at first, it has to be said. But why do you think, then, it is the case that Netflix has been so much more successful in terms of, you know, the total number of subscribers compared to Spotify? Why do you think that is?
Well, I said before, you know, it's irresistible. If you're interested in movies, most people are, you are looking at how to get those shows or television or movies at some price. I mean, $10 for movies is irresistible, and it works great, and it's unlimited, it's a no-brainer, basically, right? What are you going to pay for cable is €70. And then you don't even get the movies that you want, right? So it's a totally wipe-out proposal. And this is why they're taken off like a firecracker. This is where the cable guys and the satellite guys don't like Netflix, because I don't need them when I have Netflix. Music, to make it a wipe-out proposal like that, it would have to be in the range of a euro, right? Because then I'm saying, well, it's a total no-brainer. Of course I do this.
Well,
and this is how we get everyone, right?
I mean, I agree that the price difference perhaps is, you know, is a little bit too much. But surely is it not also the case that people are just much more used? I mean, you know, consumers are used to paying in some countries more than others, but they're used to paying on a subscription basis for audiovisual content, for TV and film. They're not for music. So, you know, it's not just the industry that has to get used to this. Do you not think that Spotify has done pretty well, really? I mean, I think in terms of the number of subscribers they've reached to date and the conversion rates, and I'm not just sucking up to, you know, Spotify being in Sweden. I actually think, you know, it's amazing how well they have done, really.
Yeah, it's amazing how well iTunes has done, considering the idiotic proposal that you don't actually own anything. I mean, hey, I love Spotify. I think they've done great. I wish them luck, you know. It's a great service. I love it. My kids love it, yes. But is it a solution on a global scale for 5 billion people? The answer is, in the current form, no. Because not 5 billion people will not do this. There will not be enough money there. It's not like Netflix, where every country in the world is writing furious emails to Reed Hastings to launch in their country. Right? Because it's a no-brainer. Right? We do the same for music. We got 2 billion users. Right? You know, this is not happening, not because the money isn't there. It's because the control of distribution is the paradigm. Right? And that is what's going to kill us. Right?